Kind sons of our cares and the two pillars, our Lord, truly blessed with us and Holy Eucharist, and our Blessed Mother. Mercy and love is self, and the Mother of Mercy. But in order to understand, we have to come back to reality, because we're living in a world like picture a crystal clear glass of water, and now picture another glass full of mud. Now the world is telling us that the muddy glass is reality, but we know that reality is a crystal clear glass. And another analogy for God is light. So here we have this candle representing God. And in the beginning was God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And out of his love, he created us in his same image and likeness. But we know that in the garden, Adam and Eve sinned, and there's original sin. And original sin is very real. But we have the answer is baptism. And when we are baptized, this is what happens. So when we are baptized, the divine, the supernatural life of God dwells in our soul. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the indwelling. And when we go to the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, Mass is a Latin word, Missa. It means to be sent. So now you're sent into the world to be the light to the world. But what happens is we're always battling the world, the flesh, and the devil. We're the church militant. We have the church triumphant in heaven and the church suffering in purgatory. And we're the church militant. But we have all the tools given to us, and the sisters are going to speak about this after. Everything we have is here for us, but it's up to us to choose. And what happens is we go out into the world, and sometimes everything is concupiscence, the world, the flesh, and the devil are trying to blow this light out. We know we have the answers, and it's always coming back to the sacrament of life, the sacrament of confession. We run, as St. Therese says, if you knew the love of God, you would run and not hesitate to his mercy and love. And so really, if we come back to the sacrament, and now we're being sent into a world that's very dark. How bright, how much light we want will be up to us to choose with every heartbeat, every thought, word, and deed. If we want to be like our Blessed Mother in Eucharistia, our yes, our entering into this passion, to preach Christ crucified in a world that preaches self-gratification and instant pleasure. But the more we live our thoughts, words, and deeds in union with God through our Blessed Mother, and we let ourselves decrease, so God may increase. Imagine a huge flame now, and we're all hearing this out in the world, Misa, the percent. And this is our hope. Everything we have, the weaker we are, the stronger we are. The more we realize our misery, the greater God's glory will shine in us. And so now the sisters are going to go more into depth on everything that we have available for us, this love and mercy being poured out to us. And this is the greatest hope we have. Just at the moment when everyone thought all was lost and all was darkness, that's when the greatest victory happened, our redemption, the crucifixion. So we hold on with Our Lady, the Mother of Mercy, the Mother of Hope, the cause of our joy. And we go, Misa, we're sent into this world to be the light, to be the hope, to be the joy, so Christ can radiate through us. And now, sisters, we're going to speak a little more about Our Lady and our Lord truly present with us.
The rest of the ocean. And
and there is a big large ship with many ships around it calling. And he said, and there are one bunch of ships have like weapons, and they are coming at all the rest to sink the large ship and those that were in with the ship. And so he said they had cannons, they had rifles, they had books, they had every imaginable weapon to try to sink the ship. And sometimes it looked like the ship was able to sink. But then up coming from the ocean were these two pillars, two columns. One was a little shorter and had our name on it with a title of Christians. And there was a larger pillar with a huge post. And it said salvation of the faithful. And the Holy Father, who was steering the ship, which represents the church, knew that he had to anchor the church to these two pillars. And so what it looked like from all these ships, there was like a big hole in the big ship, it looked like it might sink. There would be a gentle breeze that would issue from these two columns. And it would go across the ship, and it would make it, in a certain sense, it would not heal, but it would just make it better so that it could sail onward. And the Holy Father, he did, he was able to anchor the ship to these two columns. And once he did, all the ships that engaged in war against the ship sank. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about the smaller pillar, which is our name. And I think the greatest, most perfect way we can anchor ourselves to this pillar is by consecrating ourselves to Jesus through the Immaculate Heart. And I was thinking about this, and I was praying about this, and I was like, well, what does even the word consecration mean in our lives? And so I looked up the dictionary, and it says consecration is the act of consecrating or the state of being consecrated. So what does the word consecrated mean? And this is beautiful. It says, to make or declare to be sacred by certain ceremonies or rites, to appropriate to sacred uses, to set apart or dedicate as holy. And so when we take the time to do this, that what we're saying in our lives, we're saying that, you know, we want to be something, we want to be the light. Goes into the world, which means we want to be holy, we want to be different. We want someone to look at us and say, I want what they have. At least that's what we should want. And Our Lady wants us to be this awesome. You know, she helped form the heart of her son in those years of that pastor. She desires to form our heart as possible. So this is a great longing, and I just encourage you to do this. And really, ultimately, it goes back to God's mercy. He said, for the cross, he didn't have to give those words, but he chose to. He didn't have to utter those words that require people to be older than St. John. But he chose to. It was for a reason. I don't think there are two persons who love each other. Their love is like inseparable. And when we consecrate ourselves to Jesus' care, we consecrate ourselves, we bind ourselves to this love. We enter into that love. I heard a priest speak once, it was several years ago, but it was an amazing, beautiful story. He said he was of a priest who didn't really think much about our lady. And he was talking about that. You know, he said, like, you don't need her, you know, who is she? You know, all these things, you know, kind of people around. And one time he was in a deep prayer, he had this experience. He was at the foot of the cross, and there was just that young lady was there, and he was lost there. And he just spoke and saw Jesus in agony and he
why do we need her? Who needs her? You know, all these things that we need her going on. So here's the art of the sport. Here's the art of the burden of that home. So you realize the world is a lot. It's a lot of our world. It's a lot of our world. It's a lot of our world. And that's the afraid. It's a lot of our so I encourage you. You know, after you pray about this, all I can think about was love, loving a thing. You know, it's not a comfort to me. And so I was able to feel about certain things. So I encourage you, just the more you love God, the more you love a lady. The more you love a lady, the more you love God. She brings you. And I just want to tell you just a little personal testimony of my own stuff.
Supreme beauty, supreme truth, which God is supreme beauty.
in Scripture, but he taught us pray, Our Father. So we must trust in the love of God and that he gives us all these resources, everything, to lead us and care for us as children, to lead us to eternal life.
To adore him, to praise him. And St. Paul says, He destined us in love to be His sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of His will, to the praise of His glorious grace, which He freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In Him we have redemption, through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace, which He lavished upon us. In Him, according to the purpose of Him, who accomplishes all things, according to the counsel of His will, we who first hoped in Christ have been destined and appointed to live for the praise of His glory. We've been destined and appointed to live for the praise of His glory. We talk about mercy. One of the best people to consult is St. Faustina, because Jesus himself said that she was the secretary of divine mercy. So again, she has such a devotion to our Lord and Blessed Sacrament. She knew through and through that that was Jesus. Everyone here is, of course, familiar with the divine mercy image. You know, the rays coming from the heart of Jesus. And there are numerous times in the diaries of the scene where she sees those same rays coming from the monstrous. Jesus is mercy. Jesus is the Blessed Sacrament. You know, He's under the appearance of bread, it's Him. And so it's His sacred heart. You know, we think of Jesus, if He's mercy, that flows from His heart. So in Jesus showing St. Faustina repeatedly the divine grace coming from monsters and showing, this is my heart. This is the source of my love. And so we think about how can we draw this mercy to dwell in a greater capacity within ourselves so that we can receive His love more completely and be more filled more entirely so that we can offer that love perfectly back to the source. That's that exchange of love, that love for love. That's the fulfillment of our need. That's the praise of His glory that we're destined for. So we ask ourselves, how can I do this? How can I receive You more perfectly? And through the divine mercy image, Jesus shows us and teaches us. He asked specifically when this divine mercy image was painted that at the bottom of the image, the words, Jesus, I trust in You, be placed. And that was not just for no reason. Repeatedly in the diary, He speaks of a vessel of trust. That we come to the feet of Jesus, the same occasion as at His feet. We come to the feet of Jesus in the monstrance. We come to the feet of Jesus with this vessel of trust. And this is the way that we gather His mercy for ourselves and for other souls. Jesus says to St. Faustina, let souls who are striving for perfection particularly adore My mercy, because the abundance of graces which I grant them flows from My mercy. I desire that these souls distinguish themselves by boundless trust in My mercy. I myself will attend to the sanctification of such souls. I will provide them with everything they will need to attain sanctity. Are drawn by means of one vessel only, and that is trust. The more a soul trusts, the more it will receive. Souls that trust boundlessly are a great comfort to me, because I pour all the treasures of My graces in them. I rejoice that they ask for much, because it is My desire to give much, very much. On the other hand, I am sad when souls ask for they narrow their hearts. It needs one vessel only to trust. And St. Faustina speaks also of drawing from the love of our Lord for not only for herself, but for all souls. And you are each destined to praise God. We're also one, completely one body. So it's not just about our salvation. Getting us to heaven. We want to bring as many people with us to heaven as we can. We want to bring as many people to realize the love of our Lord that He remains with us. We want to bring as many as we can. And the way that we can do that is through the adoration and through trust. If I can find here, which speaks of it. Jesus, this is St. Faustina speaking. I want to bring souls to the fountain of your mercy, to draw the reviving water of life with a vessel of trust. The soul desirous of more of God's mercy should approach God with greater trust. And if her trust in God is unlimited, then the mercy of God toward it will be likewise limitless. Oh my God, you know every beat of my heart. You know how eagerly I desire that all hearts would beat for you alone, that every soul glorify the greatness of your mercy. So, once you receive God's mercy and trust, mercy leads to union, as we said. Mercy, we've been reunited with God through His mercy, through the sacrament of reconciliation. That Jesus told St. Faustina, the greatest miracles take place in the sacrament of reconciliation. He said, you don't need to go on pilgrimage to some faraway land. But you come to the feet of my representative and confess your sins, the greatest miracle takes place, that of union, back to the state of grace. We've lost that grace, comes to dwell with us again. So we think now that we're reconciled with God, the fulfillment of mercy, the fulfillment of that union is now we receive mercy leads to union. That Holy Communion is the fulfillment of that union. St. John Paul II said something to the effect that the merits of Christ's passion are not fully realized until we receive Jesus in Holy Communion. The merits of His passion are not fully realized until that moment. We adore Him, that's the glory of His passion. That's the fulfillment. He's right inside us. He possesses us, so we possess Him. And now we can praise His glory. We can adore Him. We have nothing to fear. We have no reason not to trust. He told St. Faustina, if you don't believe my words, because He gave so many words of trust, we open the Gospels with the idea of Christ's merciful love for us in mind. And just read the Gospels. It's on every page. Every page is about how much He loves us and how worthy He is of our trust. The Samaritan woman, the prodigal son, the Mary Magdalene put to His feet. All these sinners, I did not come to call the just as sinners. And so, receiving that mercy, receiving Jesus in Holy Communion, is a complete fulfillment of that. We have to ask, what's He received with gratitude, love, and trust? Jesus said, He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in Him. If we really understood that, up to in the Gospels, how many times Jesus says, your faith has saved you, or be it done unto you according to your faith. Faith, yes, an intellectual sense of faith, where I believe in what you're saying, but there's also a form of a trust. I have confidence in you. So if we have confidence in God, that's the source. That is our power. You can almost say the more the capacity that we trust, the capacity of our power, it's the capacity of our union with God, the more that we trust.
Vanish. He will settle our debts when we surrender ourselves to Him.